In the last two videos, we have seen two non-parameter tests, the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test and the Mann-Whitney-Do test, and both of them required at least one variable to be ordinal scaled. This time we'll talk about the Xi-square test, which is a test that's very good suited for archaeological purposes because it requires none of the variables to be ordinal scaled, but it can work with nominal scaled variables. And that is a case that we have very often in archaeology, where we would like to see differences in nominal scaled variables. I also would like to use this possibility here to talk a bit about data reshaping, how we come from tables to individual cases and back to tables. So most of the time you probably will have individual cases and you have to table them. And in the Xi-square test here, we also use the table as test data set. But as we have seen in the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test and also in the Mann-Whitney-Do test, there might be situations where you don't need tabled data, but the individual occurrence of some data. And that's why we will talk this time about this too. So let's start with this and let's switch over to RStudio. And I will produce here two data sets. Both are, one is from the Shannon 1997 book, and the other one is from my personal experience, so to say. We start with the Shannon example. That's about settlements that are located on different soil types. So I make a data set which I call settlements, and into that I paste in the numbers as vector, which is 26, 9, and 18 settlement occurrences, and names of the settlement vector should represent the soil type. So this is Rendzina and alluvial earth and brown earth, and I join that by an underscore. Okay, and now we have our settlements named like this. The second data set we will use is a data set about amber finds in early Bronze Age settlements or burials. So I make a variable that I call amber finds, which consists now a two-dimensional data set. So I make that a matrix. And as you probably remember, when we make a matrix, we at first have to feed in a vector of data, 6, 132, 18, and 44, and distribute that onto two columns. And when I look at the result, you can see that the data are from this vector are handled row-wise first, so as first 6, then 132 within that same column at the next row. And then we switch to the next column, which is 18, and then 44 as our last value there. Also, this data set might need some names, so column names of amber finds should equal to the occurrence of amber, so with amber and without amber. And row names of amber finds should equal to found in settlement and in burials. And now we have this data set formed like that. Okay, now how can we come from this collected, aggregated information to individual cases back? And there are several ways to do that. I will now show you the way to do that with the help of the library Reshape. And if you don't have that installed yet, you might like to install that. How this is done, we have seen in an earlier video. So I load the dataset Reshape. And at first, I start with my amber fines here. And at first, I transform them into a data frame table. And this is still possible with standard R command. So there's a command called sDataFrame, not array, but table, amber finds, and I will put that into a variable that I call amberFindCounts. And with that command, you can see that what we have before in a matrix or in a table, and now individual cases where we have the first variable, the second variable, and then the frequency available here. So it is kind of linearized there. Now, to come to real individual cases, we have to use this frequency to produce as many cases of settlement and with amber as we have frequency, so in that case 6, and the same holds true for all the rows. And there's one command from Reshape that's called untable. And if I look to the help file, it says, not very informative, that's the inverse of table. But it's actually that what we would like to have. So we would like to undo a table here. And for that we need a data frame, which is the data frame to untable, and then the numbers, so the vector of counts, which we have here in the third column. So this is the first two columns, and this is in the third column of our amberfind counts variable. So I make that into amberfind cases, where I will have the individual cases, and I use the untable command here with amberfind counts, the first two columns. So this is this part, and as second parameter I give amber finds frequency. I could also do it like that. And now we have here a long data set with 6 times occurrence of settlement with amber, and then 132 times burial with amber, and so on. So with that we have come from the table, from the aggregated information, back to individual cases, and that might be useful for certain statistical tests. And as untable is the inverse of table, I can again use table of the result to the result and get the same out that I had before. So remember the original matrix here, and we have the same values back again. And now to our second example, which is actually our first example, that's the settlements. In this case, the whole procedure is much more easy. We can just use untable for the row names, for the names, sorry, of settlements, which gives us these names here, and we append this settlement vector itself. When we do that, we have to make sure that this is a data frame, because untable expects a data frame as a first parameter. And now we have our individual cases here, where we have 26 times the Rensina, then 9 times the alluvial data, and then 18 times the brown earth here as a factor vector. And with that also we can use this data set in case that we need the individual cases for a test or another method. Okay, and again I can put that into a settlement cases variable and make a table of that. And we can see that this absolutely resembles our original data set, although the order has changed a bit, but the numbers are the same. Okay, with that excursus finished, we get back to the C-square test. So C-square is, as I said, a test for testing nominal data, and it could answer questions like, do settlements tend to be situated in rather good soil, or is the distribution random? That refers to the data set we just used. And, or, so in that case, we have only one data set, and we would like to compare that to a given distribution, for example. This is a one sample test, or a goodness of fit test. And in the other case, we compare two variables, so age, older individuals, and number of shoelace cells or other grave items that might indicate some social status. In that case, we have two data sets, so one for the older, one for the younger individuals. And in that case, it's an independence test. So we test whether the age is independent from the number of shoelace cells or the other way around. And as I said, we can test nominal scale variables, so therefore this is very useful in archaeology. We start with the first example. In general, the test requires at least one nominal scaled variable in one sample test and a second nominal scaled grouping variable in a two sample case when we have to distinguish two situations. The procedure with one sample test is we compare the observed values with expected values given a certain distribution. So for example, a random distribution or an even distribution. And here, no expected value, what that is, we'll see later on, should be smaller than 5, and the total number of cases should be larger than 50. The same is true for the two sample version. Also here, no expected value should be below 5, and the total number of cases should be above 15. And in that case, the observed values of both distributions are compared with the expected values if the sample would be evenly distributed according to both variables. The test statistics here is called chi-square, and that's why also the whole test is called chi-square test. And the significance of the test or the result depends on the degrees of freedom. What is the degree of freedom in that case? Another excurse. So, a degree of freedom in that situation, we have such a table, and that's what we kind of test with chi-square test, is the number of cells that we have to fill in before we can calculate the whole table, given that the outer numbers, the margins, are already known. So in that case, we have 398 cases in total. We know that we have 201 cremation, 197 inhumation, and 216 male and 182 female burials. How many cells I have to fill in before I can calculate the whole table? In that situation, we have to fill in one table, and from that we can calculate the number of inhumations given the total number of male burials, and also the number of female cremations given the total number of cremations and the number of male cremations, and so on. So if we just fill in one number, we can calculate the whole table. The degree of freedom is 1. So if one of the values is chosen, all others can be calculated with the help of the margins. The general formula for calculating degrees of freedom of a table is the number of columns minus 1 times the number of rows minus 1. So we have two columns, two rows. 2 minus 1 is 1, 2 minus 1 is 1, 1 times 1 is 1, so degree of freedom is 1. Given the case that we have 3 columns and 2 rows, if we just fill in one number, we might be able to calculate this number, but we still have no idea how the distribution is between these two columns here. So we have to fill in another number, and from that we can calculate the whole table again. So here we can calculate the number of uncertain cases, and for each individual column we can calculate the number of inhumations. So the degree of freedom is 2. We have to choose two values here, and it doesn't matter which of them we are choosing or we are setting. If we have set two values fixed, then all the rest follows from the margins. So again, three columns minus 1 is 2, 2 rows minus 1 is 1, 1 times 2 is 2, so we have the degree of freedom of 2. And if we have 3 and 3, of course, 3 minus 1 is 2. 3 minus 1 is 2. 2 times 2 is 4. So we have to set 4 values here in the table before we can calculate the rest. And it doesn't matter which of these values we are setting. If we have set 4 values fixed, then all the rest follows automatically. Okay. Now, how can we calculate the chi square test in case of our different soil types and the number of settlements we have there? And this falls, we will calculate two versions of the chi square test. One where we assume that the soil types are evenly distributed over the whole landscape. And the second version where we consider the proportion of the soil types of the total area differs from an even distribution. So in that case, we assume that 1/3 of the area is filled by each of the soil types. And in the second version, we consider the real case that there might be an uneven distribution of the soil types on the total area, which also result in a different chance of per se of a settlement to be on one of the soil types. So let's start with the first version. So if we have our number of settlements, and we assume that the proportion of the soil types in general is 1/3, we also would assume that 1/3 of the settlements are on the individual soil types, given that the soil type would have no influence on the distribution of the settlements. So we build up our null hypothesis. The settlements are evenly distributed on all soil types. What we are really interested in is the alternative hypothesis that the settlements are not evenly distributed on the soil types, and that's what we're actually testing by trying to reject the null hypothesis. From our expectation that 1/3 of the settlements should be situated on each soil type, it follows that 1/3 of the settlement should be present on each soil type. So if we divide the total number of settlements by 3, we get to the number of expected settlements, given that our independence is true, that soil, that number of settlements doesn't depend on the different soil types. So with that, we have our expectation value. And now comes the formula for chi square, and that's also might look intimidating in the first place, but it's rather simple. We take our observed cases and subtract the expected cases from that, square that, and divide that again by the expected cases to make different magnitudes of values comparable. And then we sum all the chi-square values up for all the cases and have our total number of chi-square, our total number of the test statistics. So how this is done? I have 26 observed cases. I have 17.6 expected cases. I subtract the observed from the observed cases, the expected cases, and I have 8.3 more observed cases than I expected. If we square that, we get to the to a squared number, and this also get rid of the sign, because we are not interested if there are less or more than expected. We are just interested in the amount or in the diversion from our expectation. So with that also we get rid of the sign and can get here something that we can sum up without having to take care of our sign. So in that case we have more than expected. In case of alluvial, we have much less than expected cases. In case of the brown earth, we are quite close to our expectation. So that's why also this value here is quite low. And to scale that to the number, total number that should be there, we divide that again by our expected cases. So in that case, we have 3.9 as our chi square value. In that case, 4.2. In that case, 0.063. So here the expectation doesn't diverge so much from our observation. If we sum the whole thing up, we get to the total chi square value, which is 8.18 or 8.19 in that case. And again, we have to look up into a table if we don't have a statistics program available. So for example, in the Shannon 1997 book, and we need the degrees of freedom to correctly identify the threshold that we have to surpass before the test becomes significant. So if we do that with a significance level of 0.05, which is the standard, we see in the table the boundary value is 5.99 or 6 approximately. Our observed chi-square difference is 8.1, so it clearly exceeds this boundary value, this threshold, and this means that the result is significant, the distribution is uneven. So this means also that the number of settlements depend on the soil type. Now, if we assume that the different soil types are not evenly distributed on the total area, again, this doesn't change anything about our observed values, but it changes our expectation, because now we would expect not 1/3 of all settlements to be represented on each soil type, but a number that is according to the proportion of the soil types. And with that we get just some new and different expectation values. And we can see that brown earth is actually overrepresented in the total area, so also here we had to have a higher expectation value than before. And then we can feed in our new numbers in the same formula. So again, observed minus expectation to the square and then divided by the expectation value. And this time our chi-square value is a bit smaller, but still it exceeds the 6 threshold, the boundary value of 5.99. So the result is still significant. Even if we consider the proportion of the soil types, we get a significant result here. Still means that the soil type had an influence about the possibility or probability to establish a settlement there, meaning probably that agriculture was relevant for the societies at that time. Okay, before we come to our two sample case, just let's try that out in R ourselves. So we have our settlements and we can feed that in the chi-square test, and the command for that is chi-square.test. If we look into the help file, we can see it expects an x as a numeric vector. It might expect a y, but we don't need this y, it's default to null. So our x are our settlements. So if we encapsulate that by chi-square test, and I'm not forgetting the q here, we get a result here. You can see, or probably you can compare, if we go back here, this is the chi-square value that's calculated by R. It's the same like we calculated. Degrees of freedom R correctly identifies that we have 2. And here's our p-value, which is below 0.05. So it also proves our assumption or our investigation here that the distribution is significantly uneven. And now to the second example, where we have given proportions of the soil type. If we look here, if we look here to the p, to the help file of the Pearson chi-square test, we can see that there is a p parameter, and this parameter is a vector of probabilities of the same length of x. So this is the probability that we have to consider in the first place, and this is our proportion of the soil types. So if we use the same command but specifying p should equal to c of 0.32, 0.25, and 0.34. There is, of course, a mistake here. It should be like that. Okay, now we have it correctly. And we have, again, the same chi-square value like we calculated. Degree of freedom stays 2. And the p-value is 0.02. So it still is a significant result, although it's a bit less significant, but still it has to be considered as statistically significant. You might wonder why we have a degree of freedom of 2, because we have only one column here, but the number of expected cases, the second column here, that we have to consider. Okay, now to, this is the same in the presentation, now to the second case where we have a two sample test, and this is a classical 2x2 situation, so we have presence or absence of one category, so settlement or grave can be considered as the absence of the category settlement, and we have ember present or not present. And this is a situation that you might have quite often if you like to test, for example, if one decoration type is associated with one type of vessel, and then you could mark here when the number where the decoration is associated with this vessel, here the number when the decoration is there but different vessel type, here this vessel type without the decoration, and here the total cases that you have without these cases before, and then you can apply the same test here. Okay, is ember primary a grave good? That's the question here. So we can observe that from the table that we have very many graves with ember and very few settlements, but the question is this statistically significant on a level of 0.05? To test that, we again use the chi-square test. This time, our expectation value is calculated a bit different. So the expectation value, if there would be no association between the different variables, would fall out of the margins. So we know that we have 24 settlements and 176 burials. So the proportion of settlement to burials, if this is just if we don't consider ember yet, is 24 divided by 176. And we know that we have 138 ember graves and 62 graves without ember. So the proportion of ember to not ember is 138 divided by 62. If the number of settlements with ember would be independent, or if the number of settlements with ember would be independent from any relationship between ember and settlement, it would be the ratio, would follow the ratio of ember to not ember and the ratio of settlement to no settlement or grave in relationship to the total number of cases that we have. So we can calculate this expectation value by multiplying the 24 with the 138 and divide that by our total number, and we get an expectation value of 16. So when there would be no relationship, no pattern here, we would expect that 16 settlements would have ember just by random distribution of the cases onto the different categories that we have here. And the same holds true for all the different tables. So we would expect, because we have very low settlements, the total number of settlements is 24, and if this would be independent from ember, it would follow the ember no ember ratio in the same way like it is for the grave situation. So it would also be this 176 total graves would fall in the total ratio of ember to no ember of the total data set. So that's why we can calculate the expected number like that. So again, we have the observed numbers. Now we have calculated the expected numbers by using the margins of the table. And the rest is again just filling these values into the formula. So our observed values were 6 in that cell. We expected 16.59. And we subtract the expectation from the observation, square that, and divide that again by the expectation. And with that, we get a chi-square value for h individual cell, and if we sum that up, we have the total chi-square value for this whole data set. So we can do it like that, and if we add up all the individual chi-square values here, we get to a chi-square value of 24.68. So this is 6 plus this 4, 15 plus this 1 plus this 2 in a way. We have a degree of freedom of 1. And if we, so because we have two columns and two rows, so this gives us a degree of freedom of 1. And we want a significance level of 0.05. And with these informations, again, we can look up in a table at the Shannon book, for example, we get a boundary value of 3.84. There is clear this chi square value that we calculated clearly exceeds this 3 point something. So the distribution, the difference in distribution is significantly not by chance. Both variables has to be assumed to be associated. So the presence of the category grave is associated with the presence of amber. It's more likely that amber occurs in the graves than in the settlements. Okay, let's do that also in R. We have already prepared our situation. We have already prepared our data set here with the amber find data. We can directly feed in this table here. So we make chi square test of amber finds. And if we compare that to what we have calculated here, you might realize that there's a difference. The chi square value here that falls out of the R command is smaller than the chi square value that we calculated by hand. Did we made a mistake here in our calculation? The answer is no, because if you look here, there's written Jates continuity correction. And that's an attempt to make this test a bit more robust in R. If this Jates continuity correction slightly changes the formula for the calculation of the chi square value by introducing this minus 0.5 in the observed minus the expected, which means when we have a small difference, this has a large effect, while if the difference is large, this 0.5 has a small effect, and this makes the whole test a bit more robust. So if we want to get rid of that, we have to explicitly specify that we want to have the chi square test without the Jates correction, which is given by correct equals to false. And if we do that, we have the same chi square value here, like we have calculated by hand. And still, also with the chi square, with the Jates continuity correction, the result is statistically significant. It's very highly significant. So there's really clearly a difference between the burials and the settlements in respect to the presence of amber. Okay, as I said, there has to be enough cases to apply a chi-square test, at least 15, and no expected value should be below 5. And if we would like to test very small data sets, which also is quite often the case in archaeology, we might need to have another test. That's the Fisher test that we will cover in the next episode. But even though the chi-square test, because it's so robust and has so low expectations on the data, is a tool that can be applied very much, very often in archaeology, you also see that in literature applied quite often. If there is a statistical test at all, most of the time it's a chi-square test. And so it's good on the one hand to know how it works, and I hope this video helped a bit to understand that. On the other hand, you also might consider using this test yourself, because it helps you very much, very good to distinguish between random effects that could come out of just pure sampling situations and real patterns that you might find in your data and from which you can draw then further conclusions. So next time, Fisher's test for very small data sets, which is essentially a chi-square test, but with a different methodology.